Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we praise you. We honor you. We worship you. We magnify you. We adore you. We just love on you, Father. We love you. We love you. We love you. How we love you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Love it. I'm just getting some worship music and we will get back straight into the sermon that we had this evening. I think I've had enough to eat. Honestly. This thing has so much open. I like it. All music in the background. Okay, so today we were, where are we at? King of Glory. Or the exact words of Father, I have to find them. Open the door, open the gates, ancient doors. Okay, just now, I'm going to find it. I'm not going to second guess. I'm not second guessing anything. Today, we're looking at the King of Glory coming in. And Father took us on this amazing journey. And God bless you, brother. And it's all a journey about being stubborn. It's about not allowing the truth of God to come in. Even his own people are blocking him out. So they built the cemetery and stuff in front of the gates because they don't get spiritual things. So we're going to look at that. And that's about where I stopped this evening, right? So let me just get the scripture in my eyesight. Give me a second. Nothing compares. Light of the world, forever. Okay, lift up your head, all ye gates, be lifted up, ye ancient doors, and let the King of Glory come in. I'm opening my scripture page. If you want, you can do that as well. I always encourage you to do that, so you can follow along and see just how Father, who is Jesus Christ, who is the teacher, he teaches us, and he lines up scripture with scripture, line on line. We don't do personal interpretation. He interprets his words. He explains his words. Because the Bible is his word. So let's just do a recap really fast so we can get there. Father, I just ask that you would have your way, Lord God. You're the teacher and I'm the mic, Daddy. I'm the student. We're all students. So just do your thing and lead the way you always do. This evening, I stopped on Zechariah 9:9, so I wanted to take a look at that. We're starting the verse before and the verse after because the Bible explains the Bible. Now, in a lot of our sermons, Father has shown several times how if the chief priests and the Pharisees and the Sadducees, if they would admit that the Messiah has come, that the Savior of the world has come, then they would lose their titles. They would lose their jobs. They would lose, the Bible, I hear him saying something, so we're going there right now. Let me just open up my scripture page right here. He says, you love to be called rabbi in the marketplace and sit in the chief seats in the synagogues. We're going there right now. We're going to Matthew 23:7, reading verse 6 to 8. No other name, Jesus, Father. Verse 6 of Matthew 23. They love the places of honor at banquets and the chief seats in the synagogues. That's what I heard. the greetings in the marketplaces, the title of rabbi by which they are addressed. I hear him saying something. He says, do as they say, but not as they do. I hope this is not bothering him. Okay. Matthew 23:3. He's lining up scripture. Look how quick. Okay. So I heard this, and we're looking at verse 2 to 4. The scribes and the Pharisees, the who? The opposite. The scribes and the Pharisees, they only believe as far as they see. The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. So practice and observe. What does that mean? Excuse me. What does that mean? They sit in Moses' seat. What did Moses do? Moses led the people. Moses gave the law. So they sit in Moses' seat. They want to proclaim the law so that there's something. Listen, but it's not the commandments that they're proclaiming. Not that alone. No, they are proclaiming the sacrificial laws, the Leviticus laws, all the things that was dealt away with on the cross. So Matthew 23:2-4, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. Do we know some people like that today? Even if they know Jesus has come, but they don't want, they want a savior, but not a king. They want a savior, but not a God. We're going there as well, where they want a king. They do not want me to be king over them. They do not want me to be king over them. So remember Moses, in the Mosaic law, it was eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, hand for a hand, whatever, stoning and all that, right? In the Mosaic law. That's why in Islam they follow it still today. They're stuck at the bottom of the mountain. But in the Mosaic law, says that. But when Jesus came, he said, listen, you have heard that it is written, thou shalt not murder. But now I tell you that he who hates his brethren has committed murder. So what did he do to the law? He amplified it. He brought a spiritual aspect to it, not just the literal thing. No, it's now the spiritual aspect of it. That is whatever your mind thinketh, whatever your heart believes. Why? Because it's not about this. We don't wrestle against flesh, but spirit. We wrestle against spirit. And when Jesus came and he died and he rose again, he gave us the Holy Spirit. He came as the Holy Spirit. Now God could dwell around his people, in his people, with his people, and his people could come to him without fear. Okay, so what did I just say? Where are we going? Oh, they do not want me to be king over them. Luke 19:27 gives us a quick glance. In our loss, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. Luke 19:27, reading from 26 to 28. I tell you that everyone who has will be given more. But the one who does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. Stop right there. What is he talking about? Everybody who has will be given more. Huh? Okay. First thing is faith. Faith. If you have faith, it's going to increase. The thing that's focused on here is the word of God. The Bible says that the word of God is like a farmer that sowed seeds, and he sowed some on, I hear him say, well, yeah, he's telling me this, so we're going there. We're looking at the parable of the sower, okay? Parable of the sower. So the farmer, he sowed some seeds. some on good soil, some on stony ground, some on the thorns, some on the wayside. And of course, the ones on the wayside and the stony ground, they didn't grow because it's stone. So there's nothing to dig the roots in. The wayside, the birds are going to eat them. The thorns are going to choke them. But the ones on the good soil, they can grow their roots in. And of course, you know, grow, bear fruit, which is us. Because God often refers to us as trees. He says the foresting, the fields, and, you know, he said we're like trees planted by the living water, which is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the living water. So we're looking here at the parable of the soul, and it's Matthew 13. It's your breath in our lives, so we pour out of praise. Okay, so we're reading the parable of the soul. Here we go. Matthew 13, let's read from verse 2. Such a large crowd gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it while all the people stood on the shore. And he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seeds. As he was scattering his seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on a rocky place, where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow, but the sun came and the plants were scorched. They didn't have anywhere to dig their roots in that they would get nourished or well watered. They withered because they had no root. Now I hear him saying something. He says, I am the root, the grafting medium. Check it out. I am the root, somewhere in Romans. Even in Revelation 22:16, but I'm looking for Romans. He said Romans. Let's just read this really quickly, okay? Revelation 22:16. It's not Carrie speaking, it's Jesus speaking. Here's what he says. Revelation 22, verse 15 to 17. But outside are the dogs, the sorcerers, the sexual immoral. Now we know that Freemasonry, they love to use this thing with the dog and the blue color. They love to use that as a symbol to them. But dogs, in biblical sense, represent the unbelievers. Remember when the Canaanite woman, she came and she said, my daughter is demon possessed, you know, and she was asking Jesus to come to her home and heal her, or come and heal her. And he said, how can I take the children's bread and feed it to the dogs? We gotta go so many. Okay. How can I take the children's bread and feed it to the dogs? So what does that mean? It means you're eager for. I mean, in times of old, Israel were the people of God, the land of Israel and all the other lands around, when they wanted to afflict them and commit war against them and all this kind of madness, you know. It was terrible because they are the people of God. But now, who are the people of God? We're under the blood of Jesus. We're washed from our impurities. We're filled up with his Holy Spirit. So what is he saying? Let's read in Matthew 15:26. God is high and God is holy. I'm looking for a scripture. Okay, there we go. Matthew 15, verse 26. The woman came and knelt before him. Verse 25 to 27, yep. Lord, help me, she said. But Jesus replied, it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Why is he saying that to a woman who's saying help her? Because he said in his word, I've come to seek and save the lost children of Israel. I have come to tells us plainly. Look how he's lining up scripture already. Oh, Father, you're awesome. Matthew 15, 24. We're reading Matthew 15 as well, aren't we? Where are we in? Okay. Oh, he's lining up scripture. There we go. Okay, Matthew 15, 24. Here's what he's saying. But Jesus didn't answer a word. So his disciples came and urged him, send her away. She keeps crying out after us. It's the same woman. It's the same woman. Oh, check it out. Oh, yes, Father. Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us. In 24, he said, he answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Israel, God reigns and rules, the one true living God. The woman came and knelt before him. Lord, help me, she said. So now we're going into what I just read. See how he's lining up line upon line? Okay, so who are the children of Israel? Obviously, they are the land of Israel. But now that Jesus has come, now Gentile and Jew are grafted in the plan like that. They're one. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. Jesus said, I am the root. I am the root. So we're going to look at him saying he's the root here now in Revelations 22:16. Because if a plant has no root, how is it going to get nutrients? Okay, so Revelations 22:16. But outside, reading from 15 to 17, verse before and after, always taking in context, not out of context. But outside are the dogs and the sorcerers. Outside of what? Well, if we want to know, we got to go back one verse. The city of God, okay? We'll just read it. So, Revelation 22:14. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life. Where's that? In heaven. And they may enter the city by its gates. What city? New Jerusalem. Remember, I saw the city coming down from heaven like a bride prepared for her groom. But verse 15, but outside are the dogs. Remember the dogs? Why is he saying dogs? Because he gave a parable and he said this. You're like a washed pig that goes back into the mud. And you're washed again, but you go back into the mud. And you're washed again, but you go back into the mud. What's the point? You're like a dog that eats its vomit. You regurgitate something because it's not good for you, but you go back and you eat and get sick and you regurgitate it again and you eat it. Ah, what am I saying? We'll go and we'll see exactly what the Bible is saying. I think it's an alignment of numbers. It's 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. I remember it's 2, 2, 2. Okay. Like a soul that is washed, this is what I hear, and goes back wallowing. Who says wallowing anymore? Wallowing in the mud. Don't wallow, honey. Wallow. Okay. I told you it was alignment of numbers. There we go. 2 Peter 2, verse 22. And we're reading the verse before and the verse after. And it says, from verse 21 to 23, it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness. Huh? Than to have known it. So, oh, they're most high and most holy. And then knowing the truth, turn away from the living God. Jesus came for sinners, not for the righteous. Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the Pharisees, you will not enter into heaven. They were far, you see. They thought they knew it all. 2 Peter 2:22. It would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than to have known it and turned away from the holy commandment passed on to them. Verse 22, of them the Proverbs are true. 2 Peter 2, verse 22. A dog returns to its vomit, and a sow or female pig that is washed goes back into a wallowing in the mud. And we're reading Second Peter 3, verse 1. Beloved, this is now my second letter to you. Both of them are reminders to stir you to wholesome thinking. So don't go back in the thing that God is taking you out of. Don't go back in the thing that He's called you out of. The Bible says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The breath of life inside your body came from God Almighty. It came from our Creator. The breath of God inside each one of us came from our Creator. And the spirit man, which is the breath of God inside of us, he knows who he came from. Now, natural food or drink cannot feed the spirit man. He needs to be fed by the Word of God. Because the Word is spirit and life. So God is sovereign spirit. And God is the Word. So God is feeding, because He's the sustaining entity. He's the sovereign deity of the universe from whom all life flows. So He's sustaining the spirit man. So the spirit man needs to feed. So as he says, as is it Peter says, to hold some thinking, to adjust your mind to the truth, to receive the truth and let it do a work inside of you. Let it quicken your flesh to step away from things that are evil, things of this world. Amen? Okay, Father. I just took some out of me. I drank one cup of water today, one, in scorching hot sun, which is not good. Okay, so how do we get here? We're going to go back and see. All right, so we're talking about him being the root, but he wants me to find a scripture in Romans. You do not support the root. The root supports you. You do not support the root. Doesn't that make sense? Think about it. Does the tree support the root? No. Does the root support the tree? Of course. Because the root dives in deep. It gets the nutrients in the soil. It gets the water. So in the case of God now, if we are likened unto trees, all right, and our faith is the root. So our root digs deep into the Word of God and takes exactly what we need to flourish and be a fruit as children of God. Okay? So we're looking at, you do not support the root, but the root supports you. How did I reach to the pig? Oh, the right. Okay, anyway. He's already lining up scripture with that, with giving the children's food to dogs. And we were looking at Revelations 22 just now, and that's how he gave us the revelation. Okay, so first I have to read this, Romans 11:18. Reading from verse 17 to 19. Oh, come to the altar. He says, come just as you are. My arms are open wide and I want you because I came for you. and your deepest, darkest sins just come. Here's what he says. Now, some branches have been broken off, and you, a wild olive shoot, because we're not born in the land of Israel. You, a wild olive shoot, have been grafted in. So this is the tree of Israel. We're just using this right now, okay? This is the tree of Israel here. God broke off some branches. So let's just pretend all in between here were fingers. Let's not. But okay, so he's showing me how, okay, and where the spaces are, the Gentiles were grafted in. See what happened? They became one. See that? I don't know. He just gave me that idea. So this is the tree of Israel. And those who don't believe that Jesus came, here. Each one of them that broke off, that were broken off, that we could be grafted in. What does it mean, broken off? Well, the Bible says simply something. He says they've been blinded. They've been allowed to go in the life that they want to follow. And who are these that are broken off? The Pharisees and the Sadducees and the chief priests and all the uppity people who think they got it all in the bag and Jesus didn't come yet and he's still yet to come. That's why they're going to receive the Antichrist when he comes, because they believe that when Jesus comes, there'll be peace and safety. But he never said that. He said, do not suppose that I came to bring peace. I came not to bring peace, but a sword of division. Remember when he said that? Do not suppose that I came to bring peace, but a sword of division. Because the Bible tells us that the word of God is like a double-edged sword. It's coming to cut, divide. That's what the sword does, and a sharpened sword will divide. So lies this way, truth this way, sheep this way, goat this way. He didn't come to bring peace. He came to bring a sword of division. Father against mother. Father against son. Mother against daughter. Daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He came to divide. Because in some places, or in all places actually, not some places, in all families, there's some good and there's some not so good. There's some truth and there's some lie. And Jesus came to divide. Jesus came to divide. Nothing else. Jesus came to divide. Okay? So, because they haven't realized, God has given them over to their blindness because they so wanted to crucify him. His own people crucified him. Why? Because he came preaching about love and how it's good for others to dwell in unity. That is, not exalting yourself above one another, but be humble before God and know that we are all dust and it's from him that life stems. So treat each other with love. Unfortunately, this world is not like that. Because Satan is on the earth and Satan's not going to allow that. So when he died on the cross and all that, you know, when he came preaching the things of the kingdom, love and gentleness and all the beautiful things of the spirit, and he came to heal the sick and the Messiah had come. But think about it now, those working in the temple, those with the evening sacrifice, those collecting taxes from the people, those collecting tithes from the people, even today's church, robbing the people. Okay, so if Jesus were to come now, you know what he would say? He would say, you've made my house into a den of thieves. You've made my house of prayer into a den of thieves. It is what it is. They say they enter into the houses of widows. Why? They mourn. Widows mourn for their husband. And they don't have comfort. They have the church that's supposed to be a spiritual house. But then when they go and they say, if you believe, put all that you have and sell your house and sell your car and put the biggest amount that you can give. Glory to God. They have no one to sustain them. And yet, churches are robbing them. It is what it is. I'm not here to sugarcoat anything. It is what it is. So, Father, he just shows us that, you know, the world is really far gone. Because Satan and his fallen angels are on the earth. They're not in hell. They're not in some dark hole. They probably hide in some dark hole. But they're on the earth, busy as ever. Because they were cast down from heaven. And we get to go to heaven. They don't want us to go to heaven. Because we get to go through the blood of Christ. That's why Satan has done his utmost during the ages. Thousands and thousands of years. To deny the blood of Christ. In every possible way. But God will... He will turn things around. You'll see. He says, behold, I'm doing all things. I'm making all things new. So those who were first will be last. You think you could preach before? You think you were filled up with the Spirit? Look at the man who's beating his chest. Saying, God, I thank you that I'm not like these sinners. And the tax collector hangs his head down. Or the sinner. And says, Father, forgive me. I'm a sinner. Or that's what God wants right there. That is exactly what God wants. And of course, those who are exalted will be brought low. They'll be humbled. And those who are humble will be exalted. Amen. So, without getting too mushy. Without getting too mushy. Matthew 10:34. Reading from 33 to 35, and it says, but whoever denies me before men. Now Jesus is a living word. He's a living word. So when you're called forth to be a witness of him, it might be in a simple question, it might be in a simple conversation. It might be in an action. It might be in a vote. It might be in so many things. Here's what he says. But whoever denies, Matthew 10, verse 33 to 35. But whoever denies me before men, that is humans, I will also deny him before my Father in heaven. Do not assume that I came to bring peace to the earth. What did he say? Do not assume that I've come to bring peace to the earth. We're reading that wrong. Let's read it properly. Matthew 10, verse 34. Do not assume that I've come to bring war to the earth. How many people's souls are just saying, that's better. No. The Bible says, do not assume that I've come to bring peace to the earth. I've not come to bring peace, but a sword. I've come to turn a man against his father. But I thought Jesus was nice. He is nice. He's so nice. He's so holy. He's so good that he doesn't want us to go to hell. So he's come to rebuke, and he's come to chasten, and he's come to rightly divide. Divide what? Not just people from people, but you from yourself. What do I mean? Your spirit man from your flesh. He's come to give the word in such a dose, like an injection, like a vaccine. He's come to give you such a dose, give us such a dose, that when the truth comes, it'll set us free. And he is the truth, the way, and the life. So when the truth comes, it'll break the chains that the world has been holding us to. It'll set us on the path that God wants us to come to go to heaven with him. And it'll lead us to that path, eternal life. Amen? So he says, I've come to turn a man against his father and the daughter against her mother and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Not the words of Carrie, the words of Jesus. See, there it is. All right. Now we're reading Romans 11, verse 17. So remember, this is Israel, and all of the spaces in between are people who don't believe. So this is the land of Israel, the people of the land of Israel. This is okay. These are the Gentiles. These are the Gentiles. So the Americas, the Africans, Europe, the Caribbean islands, China, Australia, okay? And God does this because this is the tree of Israel, of the people of that land, right? So the root is here. This is the root. The root is here, okay? And God takes the Gentiles because of these unbelievers that are now missing. They've been broken off. He takes the Gentile. And look what he does. Anybody did agriculture? I did. I got a double award in it. Look. Look what happens. He grafted us in to the natural tree. See that? So we weren't born of the land of Israel, but we were born in our country. But through the blood of Christ and his Holy Spirit, we get grafted in. And now look. The root makes us one with it. So now we're going to read in Romans 11, verse 17 to 19. Now some branches have been broken off in you, a wild olive shoot have been grafted in among the others to share in the, remember the roots is here, because Jesus said, I came for the lost sheep of Israel. So, where am I? Okay, have been grafted in to share in the nourishment of the olive root. Do not boast about the branches that were broken off. So they're blind that we could see. They're not received the Holy Spirit yet because we got it. The Bible says now the fullness of the Gentile must come in. So the fullness of the Gentile, what does that mean? The full number. Fullness of the Gentiles, right, must come in, the full number. Of course, those not on the land of Israel, that's okay. We don't need to be on the land of Israel. What we need to be is under the cross of Calvary and filled up with the fire of God's Holy Spirit so that we're one with him. So okay, we're going in Romans. Oh, also Roman, he's doing scripture. He's lining up scripture now. Here we go again. So we just read Romans 11. We're going back into Romans 11 because he's lining up scripture again. Romans 11, 25. And he says in verse 24 to 26. Why my eyes burn? My eyes burn. I think I stuck my eye just now. Okay, check this out. Romans 11, 25. For if you were cut from a wild olive tree, remember we weren't grown in the land of Israel, and contrary to nature, so this is impossible with man. It is not so. You cannot graft a wild olive tree into a natural olive tree. They will not mix. And contrary to nature, we're grafted into one that is cultivated How much more readily? Okay, so you were grafted in, we were grafted in by the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ, into the natural olive tree. But those were broken out. So here's what the Bible says now. He says, how much more those who are broken off could also be grafted in by the love of Christ. And it says in verse 24 of Romans 11, how much more readily will these, the natural branches, that is the people of the land of Israel who were broken off, that we would be grafted in, be grafted in their old olive tree. I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers, so that you will not be conceited. Don't be prideful. Don't be lifted. You from Israel and you don't even have the truth and you are blind and you were broken off and God has cut you off from your, you know. No. Father says, don't do that. And here's what he says here. He says in verse 25, I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers, so that you will not be conceited. Don't be prideful. God hates that. A hardening in part. Remember what we're talking about today? They've been hardened. They've been stubborn to listen, stubborn to see. They refuse to see Jesus on the cross as the Messiah. They refuse to hear the things that he preached. Why? For pride. For that lovely word called pride that God hates and he's going to burn the earth for. Because, don't lose it. Okay, so he said they stop their ears and they block their eyes because they don't wish to hear. The truth is given to them, but they refuse it. They reject it. Listen, a hardening, verse 25 of Romans 11, a hardening in part has come to Israel until the full number of the Gentiles has come in. So right now, it's not about those who are born in the land of Israel that will be saved alone. No, it's those who are born by the water and the Spirit, believing that Jesus came, he lived a perfect life for you, he died for you in your place for your punishment, for every single bad, evil thing you ever did, rose again on the third day to give you victory in him. I'm trying to get back my point. Okay, so, just give me a second. Right, so a hardening has come in part. Okay, so until the full number of the Gentiles are coming. So how do we come to Christ? We believe. We have not seen him in Israel on the cross ourselves. But God never said he was pleased with sight. He said he was pleased with faith. He said, I am well pleased by faith. Now faith is the stubborn. I'll show you an example of faith right now. I'm thirsty. I'm imagining right now a bottle of juice in my hand. I can see it in my hand. It's right here. Can you see it? Can you see it? It's right here. It's orange juice. Now, look at faith. I believe it right now that it's here. It's right here. I can see it. There it is. And look, this is God. There it is. And the world goes, huh? She's lost her mind. Or like, I don't see anything. What? There's the juice. And God does this. There we go. The poppy. So, faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's not there, but you're declaring that it's there. The evidence of what you hope for now becomes seen. People ask me, how can you see Jesus in the clouds? What's going on? What's up with it? Why can't... Listen, before I could see him, I believed that he's there. I believe that he's there. Before I could even see him, before he even showed up to me, and he said, it's a gift. He said, it's a gift because you've sought me. Because blessed are those who are pure in heart. They will see the face of God. Listen, he said, okay, let's not lose the message. So he said, the full number of the Gentiles has to come in. All those who are going to believe, all those who are going to receive. Just like he said in the fifth seal, the souls of the martyred saints, they're under the altar of heaven, and they're crying out, how long, Lord? How long till you avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? And he said, just a little while longer, rest a little while longer, until the rest of your brethren are killed. So it begs us the question, who are the saints in heaven? Those who bore witness of Christ, those who bore witness with their lives, those who had to stand up to the testimony and not ignore it, and I'm loved by you, and not deny him. The Bible says, okay, so we're going there now. It's bringing back our study from today now. So we're going into my legs are folded kind of, and I'm just getting cramped. Okay, Revelation 6:9. It's who I am. And I looked, verse 8-10. And I saw a pale horse. Its rider's name was Death, and Hades, which is hell, followed close behind. Why? Because after death is what? Judgment. And they were given authority. Who they? The rider and death and hell. Listen, they were given authority over a fourth of the earth to kill by sword and by famine, by plague, and by the beast of the earth. And again, I tell you, beast is kingdom in Revelations, and woman is church. And when the Lamb opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who have been slain. No, I'm not sleepy. Satan, go away. They don't want me to get this message. And I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God. So what I heard in the spirit, they loved not their lives till the death. So they had been slain for the word of God. The word of God and the testimony that they held, which is Jesus Christ is our Savior and our Lord God Almighty. They knew him. They cried out in a loud voice. Who? The souls that were killed on the earth for the testimony of Christ. They're now in heaven crying out for God to exempt judgment. And they cried out in a loud voice, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge those who live on the earth and avenge our blood? I need to wake up. And the Bible says they love not their lives to the death.
Victory.
2 Thessalonians 2, verse 9 to 11. I'm struggling to keep my eye open. The cult should give me a friend piece. Second Thessalonians 2, verse 9 to 11. Mm-hmm. So, instead of this way, they flip it this way. What does that mean? They're Xing him out. Here's what it says. Second Thessalonians 2, verse 10. The coming of the lawless one. The who? The Antichrist. The coming of the lawless one will be accompanied by the working of Satan with every kind of power and sign and false wonder. The coming of the lawless one? The Antichrist. Because he opposes himself above God. He exalts himself above everything that is called God. So the coming of the lawless one will be accompanied by the working of Satan with every kind of power and sign and false wonder. That's why when people get healed, when some preachers pray for them and they go back, and suddenly they're worse as they were, they're worse than they were, or they are sick again, some die. Why? Because they're using different spirits. They're not using the Holy Spirit. It's not Jesus, because they're not preaching Jesus. They're preaching their own gospel, their prosperity gospel, the Kundalini gospel, their angelic gospel, their food and drink gospel, their marriage gospel. They're preaching all sorts. And the spirits that come to entertain these lies, what happens? They do all kinds of signs and false wonders. Wow. If they would only preach this gospel, they would be in some trouble. If it were fire were to come down from heaven and consume them themselves. All right. So 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 10. And with every wicked deception, he wants to deviate. He wants to divert. Excuse me, I'm only belching because I just ate and I don't know. I just wolfed down my lunch. And with every wicked deception, deceiver, who deceives the world? There's something deceives the world. What was his name again? Who deceived Adam and Eve? Satan. The devil deceives the whole world. Your name is Victory, Jesus. We'll rise to Christ our King. Isaiah. Okay, first let's read Revelation 12:9. Please wake up. Body, don't fall asleep. Oh, I need sugar. I don't know. I'm gonna just get that.
By your spirit I'm alive.
By your spirit I'll rise. Higher still. Higher still. My God. Yes, Father. Okay. Revelation 12, verse 11. I'm sorry. Verse 8 to 11. I'm prevailed not. Who? The dragon and his legion. Neither was a place found anymore for them in heaven. That's what he's vexed about. He's angry that he got kicked out. He had everything in heaven. Everything. And he was a chief worshiper. And now look where he is. His countenance is fallen. He's ugly. He's he has to be placed into outer darkness. That's his place. I'm prevailed not. Neither was a place found anymore in heaven. And the great dragon, the great dragon was cast out. That serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceive the whole world. So he's called the devil and Satan and the dragon and the serpent. That's what he's called. And he was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Hmm. So, wow, I've got a lot of windows open, maybe like 40 windows. But okay, so hear this. He was cast out of heaven, and he doesn't want us to go because he can't. You know, there are some people who don't like you having what they can't have. All right. Satan's just like that. So, verse 10 of Revelation 12. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down. Who are our brethren? A few things we're going to look at here. This joins perfectly with John 12:30, where he said, now judgment has come unto the world. Why? Now, if the Son of Man be lifted up, he will draw all men unto him. Amen. He says, now judgment is upon the world. And the prince of this world, which is Satan. The world is running by the systems of Satan. So now the prince of this world is cast out. Look at that. Amen. And God will be exalted. So John 12:30 joins up perfectly with this one. And Revelation 12, where are we? Verse 10. Right. Two things I have to examine for you. He says, now the prince of this world is cast out. What's the other one? Do not do that, for I am a fellow servant of you, of the God you worship. Do not do that, for I am a brethren. I am a fellow servant of God. That's what I hear. So we're going to look at that. We're looking at John 12, 30 to 32. I can't see anything. Okay, here we go. John 12, I see everything. Here we go. John 12, 30 to 32. In response, Jesus said, this voice was not for my benefit, but for yours. What is he talking about? When John the Baptist went to baptize him, and there was a voice in heaven, and some said it thundered, and some said an angel spoke to him. Remember that? Do we need to go there, Father? We need to go there. Okay. We're going there. Some said it thundered. And some said an angel spoke to him. You are holy. So God is lining up scripture again. Here we go. John 12, 29. Reading from 28 to 30, Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing there heard it and said it thundered.
Wow.
Others said an angel had spoken to him. Verse 30. In response, Jesus said, this voice was not for my benefit but for yours. Now remember today when we were also examining, we were examining them wanting to stone him when he said, I am he. Before Abraham was, I am. Because I am is God's name. I am. So, oh no, I'm losing. No! Darn. I lost it. Darn, what was I going to say? What was I saying? Right. So today when I was, this evening, when I was doing the first part, I was saying, well, Father was showing us how, you don't have to give it back to me. The words aren't coming right now. Right. He says, if I bear witness of myself, my report is not valid. You know, my report doesn't really count. So another is bearing witness of me. And he says, the spirit of truth bears witness. The one who you say is your God has sent me. But you see, they didn't know the spirit of truth, which is the Holy Spirit. So therefore, they couldn't receive it. They didn't perceive it. They couldn't receive it. It was a terrible day for them. One moment, please. Let me get some music. Hosanna. Okay, so he was saying, you resist the Holy Spirit, right? And that was in Acts with Stephen. He said, you resist the Holy Spirit. So we're looking now, Father's saying, here's what he's saying. A crowd heard it, so he has witnesses, and said that it thundered. And some said an angel had spoken to him. In response, Jesus said, this voice was not for my benefit, but for yours. He's not benefiting anything out of it, except the good pleasure of having his creation back with him in eternity. That's what he's benefiting from it. There's nothing else that he's benefiting from it. The glory and the honor and the praise, it all belongs to him already. So it's not like he needs anything to glorify him. He's glorified. Okay, so John 12, he tells us that now judgment is upon this world. Now the prince of this world will be cast out. No, the prince of the world, Satan, come, I came to lie, steal, kill, and destroy. That's the agenda of Satan. So he comes to lie. That is deceive. So we don't perceive and receive the truth. I'm rhyming. And then he comes to steal. Steal what? Just like the seed scattered on the stony ground or the wayside or where else? Among the thorns. Not in good places. Hearts aren't open to receive it. He's come to snatch the seed. That is the word that has been planted. Yeah? So he comes to steal so it does not bear root. And then, of course, shoot and fruit. Why am I rhyming so much? Okay. So, what's the point of me saying this? Right. So he shows us that, you know, that's how Satan is. He comes to lie, steal, kill, and destroy. To destroy, what does he want to destroy? You think he wants to destroy just your body? He doesn't want to destroy your body only. God made us as vessels to dwell in. That's why when he comes at the resurrection, we will be changed. We shall be as angels. We shall be as angels. We'll receive that glorified body. Now, the spirit man in us is going to be overjoyed because the things of this world is no longer making sense. It's a crazy place. Nothing is making sense. The things of the flesh, they have no profit. But the things of the spirit are eternal life. So, Satan wants to snatch. Just like he snatched from who? Even Adam. Remember when they were in the Garden of Eden and they didn't die, they didn't get sick. Well, what happened to them? Well, Satan came along and he said, that tree that God said, don't touch, lest you die. Or that tree that God said, don't eat from. He said, don't touch it, because when you touch it, you're gonna get tempted. Don't touch it. Don't eat from it. So that tree that he said not to touch, they touched and they ate. They took in the serpent's words over the creator's words. Now, had God let them remain like that, they would have remained evil forever, and God would have had to destroy them and cast them off into hell with Satan. But God loved them. So he put them out of the garden. He put an angel to guard the tree. Amen? Glory Genesis. Genesis 3. And so that they couldn't eat from the tree and live forever. That is the tree of eternal life, which is the tree that he promises to give us. That tree that bears 12 different fruits every different month of the year. Can you imagine that? Oh, awesome. I want a tree like that. Okay. So Father shows us that Satan comes to lie, steal, kill, and destroy. So he wants to kill who? He wants to kill faith. He wants to kill the truth. He can't kill the truth. He can try, but he can't. He wants to kill us, as in take us out of this life, because it is written, after death comes what? Judgment. Uh-oh. So Satan is giving, he'll make your life so sweet if you follow in the flesh, if you go against everything that God has said to do. He will make your life so sweet. You'll have the richest everything. You'll have the woman, or either the cars, you'll have the money, you'll have the house. Serpent is gonna love on you. He's gonna say, I just want them to just trust me just a little. And then he snatches. And he injects that poison in, that his deception flows. And before you know it, you can't think straight. Something's going on with your trust in God. You don't even care about God anymore. What's going on there? Something's different. Now the things of the world is what you want. And that little voice that said, come to me. I'm calling you, come. And you decided to go the other way instead. Satan has taken control of that. And he pulls you into the pit. The Bible says the blind leading the blind, both will fall into a ditch. So, what is Satan blinded by? Pride. Pride. What is the Pharisees blinded by? Pride. What are man exalting churches blinded by? Pride. What are souls that refuse to turn to Jesus Christ blinded by? Pride. What are they trying to do? Block God. They've lost their minds. They're trying to block God out. They're like this, not like this. They're like this. You know, and this is where the persecution of Christians come in. Not just any kind of Christians. The ones that hold the word. The ones that are lifting up his word. And they, wow, this morning, this ties in with the message this morning that he gave me before I even came on here to say anything. This morning he told me, remember when he told me, he said, something like this. I don't know. Go and check it on my wall. He said they want to take pieces of the Bible out according to their lives and you know, just make it crooked, not straight. So they're trying to build their own doctrine in a sense. God said this? No, God didn't say that. But okay, we'll put that in there anyway because it fits our lifestyle. It said something like, if they would stop trying to change the word of God, then the world would be such a better place and more souls would be saved. I really need to drink water. Okay, I know that. I know. I need to drink water. Excuse me a second. If you don't have enough water in your body, your blood will become too thick. And then you begin to get tired too easily. So we don't want that. Tiring is enough as it is. So they don't lift up the word of God, but they try to go between the pages and interpret themselves. And this is not what God meant. God meant this. This is like Satan in the garden. This is Eve. God told me not to touch from the tree. Did God say that? Yeah, God said that. Well, God said that, but God didn't really mean that. No, He knows that the day you eat from the tree, you'll be like God. Now, He wasn't lying, but He put in a piece that made it sound good. He made it sound good because she was like, okay, well, you know, the tree looks good. The fruit looks really good, you know. And then she reached and she touched it. And I went, this feels really good. Wow. I can smell it. Wow. Uh-oh. Look what's happening now. Her spirit man is beginning to be submissive to the flesh. So she's given in to 2, 3, 4, 5. She's given into a 5 senses there already. She's already done it. Sight, 5 UCs, scent, because she probably smelt the fruit. The only thing she hasn't done is tasted yet. No, 3, 4, 4. Okay, so 4 senses. She's touched it. Uh-oh. And she's already listened to the serpent. So the spirit man that was in fellowship with God has been brought low. And the flesh is now exalting itself above the spirit man. So she can't hear what the spirit man is saying. She can no longer hear the voice of God saying, do not touch. Now she hears, it is good, and you'll be like God. And she took it and she ate it. Now that's what Satan wants. Satan is trying. He's a crazy man. That's all I have to say about him. He's a crazy angel. He tried to exalt himself above God once in heaven. He got kicked down. He and his angels. He got condemned forever. He got to crawl on his belly. And he got to eat dust. That is Satan's food. Dust. He's a snake. Now, what was the thing I was saying? Right, he's a madman. He hasn't learned his lesson twice. No, he wants it a second time. He wants it a third time. Because third time, on the third day, we know what happened. Amen? We know exactly what happened on the third day. Victory in the name of Jesus. Okay. So, Satan wants to substitute the words of God for his words. Did I say that right? We want to substitute his words for the word of God. Well, whatever. He wants to put his words in the words of God. And he wants to make his own doctrine. And he's done that. And the Bible shows us that there's a real vine. And there's a true vine. That is the vine of heaven. That is Jesus Christ. And there's a fake vine. The vine of the earth. And the vine of the earth says, come, let's join as one, because it's one God we serve. Hallelujah. And it doesn't matter how you come to him, just come. You just have to believe in a high state of consciousness. And all this rubbish. And the vine of the earth says, you'll have peace and safety if you side. It's all about love. And of course, gay marriage comes in here, because God said gayness is an abomination in his sight. It's sodomism. And God destroyed an entire city, Sodom and Gomorrah, for sodomism. It's not just that, it's abortion. They're killing the unborn, the voiceless. Who knows, a prophet would have been one aborted. A prime minister, a president that would rise up for God, a preacher, an evangelist, an apostle. Who knows who was in the womb, because God said, I purposed you in this world for my word, my work, my glory. And he says, I've purposed you for my glory. And I before you were in your mother's womb, I knew you. If your spirit man is calling you to listen to the word of God, it means your spirit is thirsty. Your spirit is deprived from the work which you were sent to do. And he wants it. And nothing in life is going to suffix. Nothing in life is going to suffice. It's never going to be enough. So we have people doing drugs and sexual immorality and even food. Some people are eating their way to happiness until they feel full and they knock out with diabetes and heart disease and blood disease and you name it. This world has gone into overdrive and craziness because Satan has come down having great wrath against the church and the woman and her male child, which is the church, and the people or the soul that is led by the Spirit of God. So, our scripture verse, we haven't even examined our scripture verse yet. We're going in there right now. What is our scripture verse again? Okay, so let's just read out John 12, 31 to 32. Now judgment is upon this world. Now the prince of this world will be cast out. Now why did Jesus say this voice was heard for your benefit and not mine? He already knew who he is. He know he's the flesh that's subjected to only the sovereign spirit. So who is this voice for? Those who cannot believe without seeing. Now they can hear and believe. Because God desires no one to perish, but all to come unto repentance. It's who are willing to come. The gates are open. The blood is flowing off the cross. God is saying, who will come? There is therefore no condemnation in them that believe. Will you believe and come? Okay, so he said that they might know, or even, hey, on the third day when he rose again, you know, we did hear he is the Son of God. When he performed all the miracles, he is the Son of God. It said the Messiah would come. The Messiah has come. All this will happen. All this revelation will happen when the fullness of the Gentiles has come in and that time is near. The gospel is being preached in every corner of the earth. Oh, I feel him. The gospel is being preached in every corner of the earth. Amen. And every person who could not know Jesus now knows Jesus. If it's by internet, if it's by missionaries out there, if it's by churches that are exploding on the earth to bear the truth, Jesus is the Christ. And even if their agenda is selfish, God says, it's okay. I will take a thing that is meant for evil and I'll turn it around for good. Because he's good like that. He says, behold, I'm making all things new. Amen. So now we're looking at 32, and here's what he says. When I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto myself. Because Jesus didn't come to condemn. He came to save. That is on the cross. He said, come, just as you are. I don't care how filthy you are. All the righteousness of men are filthy rags before God. The Pope, oh, especially him, the Pope, the preachers, the evangelists, the apostles, the teachers, the pastors, the prophets, all are filthy rags before me. Because only God is holy. Only God is pure. So now these titles, look at this now. We're going to look now at our scripture verse because it's tying in here. These titles are why the scribes and the Pharisees and the chief priests and the people of Jerusalem, well, not all, but you know what I mean, the ones who are satisfied with the business as usual and the Messiah hasn't come. So, okay, so if I hated this one, then it's okay because what he's saying doesn't really count because he's not really the Messiah. Or if I was sleeping around, and now it's not just if I sleep around, but it's if, oh my goodness, if I look at a woman now, I commit adultery. It doesn't matter because he's not the Messiah. Jesus is not the Messiah. So you see how it is? All those who didn't want to hear the things that he said, they denied him. The Bible says somewhere in a very sad account. I need some water. Let me just get some water. Okay. I don't think that's going to help, but the Bible says I'm getting a headache now. Okay, the Bible says in a very sad account in Isaiah 53, he had no formal comeliness that they should, when they saw him, they would behold him. Because he was, because he was bruised. He was wounded for our transgressions. And he was bruised for our iniquities. He was wounded. He was mocked. He was slapped. He was spit on. He was beaten beyond recognition. He was, his flesh was peeled off of him. He was dragged through the streets. He hurt so bad. The Bible says in Isaiah 53, here you get a hold of yourself. The Bible says that he has no form of comeliness or beauty. He has no form of comeliness or beauty that when we see him, we would desire him. We never look upon him as a king. We never look upon him as a king. We never look upon him as our Lord. And they put the crown of thorns on him. They didn't realize that they were even hurting their father when they pierced his hands. They didn't realize that they pierced the very hands that formed him, that formed them. The Bible says that they who pierced him, oh my goodness, I'm melting. The Bible says that they will look upon him, they who pierced him, and they will mourn. They will cry. They will mourn to see him coming in the clouds of glory because they will realize whom they pierced. How did I get here? Where was I? Okay, let me just. So I'm going to my scripture verse. If I can just hold it together, Carrie. Okay, here we go. They did not esteem him because they didn't want their daily lives interrupted. They didn't want their hatred to go away. They didn't want their adultery to go away. They didn't want their self-righteousness to go away. They loved their titles. They loved their exaltation from men. They loved to be the eye-pleasing spectacle. They loved to be called rabbi in the market. Remember, we read this before. So they denied him, even when they saw him on the cross, even when he prayed for them. They denied him, they pierced him. They mocked him. They told him, come down from the cross, you know, they mocked him. And all the while he's saying, if you only knew that I could call legions of angels to help me and they would take me down in a second. But that you might be saved and you might be with me, I have to hold on here. And though I feel the pain of a man, I am the Almighty God. I am your Father, the Almighty God. He says, I'm holding on in this strength because the love of me as Father is greater than the pain of me as the Son. Oh, that was revelation. Come on, take it in. I don't think I can say that again. Wow, that just blew my mind. Wow. Father, wow. Okay. So the strength of the Almighty God is what kept Jesus on the cross, because he was fully God, fully man. Flesh subjected to spirit. He was fully God, fully man. And still they didn't esteem him. But he said, if you only knew. He's looking down, you know, and he says, woman, behold your son. When he said, woman, behold your son. He might have been talking to Mary because Mary was right there. But woman in Revelation is church. So can we go deep? Deep calls onto deep right now. Woman, behold your son. Church. Church, wake up and behold the son. Behold the strength of the son. Listen, woman, behold your son. That echo with you and resounding you a little bit. And he was saying, if you only knew that I could call multitudes of legions of angels and they would come. Scores of angels and they would come. They would come and take me down. But that you might be with me again in paradise, I must hold on to you. And this thing must be accomplished. For it is written, without the shedding of blood, there remains no sacrifice for sin. That it pleased God to afflict the Savior. Ooh, my heart. Ooh, I get a pain in my heart. Okay. It pleased God to afflict the Savior. That the chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. That we might have peace in this world. And Jesus said this. Peace I give you. I don't give you as the world gives. I give you what I give. You have the peace in knowing that I'm with you. You have the peace in knowing you can do all things in me. You have the peace in knowing that death and hell has no power over you now. Because what I did on the cross, it's for you. Peace I give the world. Let's just go there really quickly before I get into the scripture. Almighty God. Father. Here we go. John 14:27. Aruach ve'akala. Okay, here we go. John 14, verse 26 to 28. But the advocate, The who? The helper. The Holy Spirit. The teacher. The guide. The counselor. The comforter. Here's what he says. The advocate. The Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I've told you. Some people think I've read the Bible. Like, I mean, I've memorized the Bible. Don't ask me where the verses are. Only when he gives me, I know. He said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. This is John 14, verse 27. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. You heard me say, I'm going away and I'm coming back to you. First, wait, he's gone away to prepare a place for us. Amen. But even so, he was speaking of this. I've gone away. Oh no. Okay. Whew. Holy Spirit told me, charge the charger. I looked in time. Here we go. I'm charged the modem. Okay, so here's what he said. Here's what he's even saying. I must leave that as you see me now, you know me, okay? But I must leave so that you might believe in something unseen. That is me as God. Listen to what he says. I'll go away. I'm going away. I am going away. And I'm coming back to you. And he came to us as tongues of fire, testifying of the Son. Because what the Holy Spirit came and did was rise up a testimony of who Jesus is. And all the things that he taught the disciples while he walked, oh, Holy Spirit, I feel him. Wow. He says, oh, everything that he taught them, he just reminded. And that is what he's doing now, even now. Now, remember when they began to, in the upper room, in one accord, when they stood there? Sharabaha. Woo! I'm getting just, I don't know what to call that. I'm just quickened. He says they were in the upper room and they were standing in one accord. What does God call us to do? One Lord, one faith, one baptism. He calls us to stand as one with him as the head, Christ as the head. Why? What is in the head? The mind. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Remember, we looked at the spirit has a mind. Remember, the Bible says somewhere that the mind of the spirit is life. Okay, well, you can go and look at that. I'll give you homework. Go look at that. Okay, I'll find it. The mind of the spirit is life. So Christ becomes the mind. Romans 8. Almighty God. And this is what the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the chief priests, the uppity churches, the uppity men, all who exalt itself above Christ is refusing to do. They're refusing to be renewed by the Spirit. That is Jesus Christ himself in the Spirit. That is God himself. Romans 8, 5 to 6 to 7. I'm counting. Those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on things of the Spirit. Live according to the Spirit. What does that mean? It means to allow Jesus to lead. He said, we are one body, many members, because we are many souls, but each one is a connection of the other. If we would find it, we would stop trying to be uppity and exalting ourselves above each other and just standing unity in the truth. This is just one way of saying truth, okay? This is the written word, which is spirit and life when we read it, because then we get something that is unseen, that is the living word, that is the spirit of truth. And in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. Amen? So Romans 8:6 says, the mind of the flesh is death. So the flesh has a mind. Yeah, we all acknowledge that our brains are in our heads. But the mind of the spirit, huh? The spirit has a mind, is life and peace. Romans 8, verse 6. Why? And that's a sermon. I think I did that. I hope I did that. I really hope I did that. The mind of the spirit is life and peace. Because if you're led by Jesus, then you're walking in the right way. So you have peace. Whether you live or you die, you live to Christ. You'll go to heaven. Peace. In that you know you're pleasing God. You're not being an eye pleaser of men. And life. Eternal life. Why? Because you know in whom you've trusted. You know in whom you've believed. All right. So let's read it out. Because the mind of the flesh is hostile towards God. Uh-oh. It is not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. So remember that little demonstration I was doing with Eve and the serpent, and where her spirit had to lay low and the flesh, all the senses came alive. So this is why the Bible says the things you can see in the world, they're temporary. Everything is temporary. But the things you can't see are the things that are eternal. Okay. So here's what verse 7 of Romans 8 and verse 8 says. Romans 8 and Romans 8:7. Because the mind of the flesh is hostile towards God. It hates the things that God hates. It hates holiness. It hates order. It hates instruction. It hates truth. It hates light. Everything that God is, it hates. I'll talk to you in a while, Brother Andrew. What you did this morning was not good. And I had to rebuke you for it, okay? Now, here's what he says. Because the mind of the flesh is hostile to God, it does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Once you're like this, you'll never submit to God's law. No perfect word, no perfect thought, no perfect deed. That's why Jesus came, remember? Fully God, fully man. Those controlled by the flesh cannot please God. All right. Now we go into a scripture. Not yet. Okay, yeah, now we go into a scripture. I skipped a verse, but we'll come to that in a minute. Okay. He'll tie it in. What is our scripture? Let the King of Glory come in. Something like that. Let me just find it. Almighty God. Where is the worship music? I don't think we're hearing anything. Hey, my brother, sing. Holy Spirit loves music. Okay, here we go. Worship music. We're looking at, what was today's scripture? Come on, where is it? I want to read it as it is. Okay, well, I'm almost there. A little bit after that picture. Here we go, right here. Okay, and he says, oh, come on, just a little bit more. One sec. Oh, darn. I don't know where it is. Where is it? Did I delete it? I didn't delete it. Oh, there we go. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye ancient doors, and let the King of Glory come in. That's our scripture. Here we go. Lift up your head, O ye gates. Which gates? lift up your head. Oh, yikes. Well, we tell the story of Satan stealing keys. Keys to where? Keys to heaven. Adam and Eve got kicked out of heaven for disobedience. And what has Jesus come to do among us? Lead us in the path that he is taking us. Okay, that's where he comes in to do. So, I'm not denouncing him as a savior. He's the savior. He came to save. But he came as the Holy Spirit to lead us in the way that is truth, the way, the life, the narrow and straight path that God calls us to walk on, that we cannot walk in him with the flesh. We must walk according to the Spirit. So, lift up your head, O ye gates. The gates of heaven were sad to see Adam and Eve going. You know that? Now, when Jesus made a public spectacle, I love to do that. He just held Satan by the scruff and said, come here, you. You took the keys from them, but I'm giving it back. Because I defeated, of course, he's God. He defeated the grave and hell. And now he's won back the keys for us. So, we're going to read that now. Oh, I'll run into your arms. That's exactly what we're going to do right now. Lift up your head, oh ye gates. Light of the world. I run into your arms. I run into your arms. Psalm 24. Psalm 24. Take it in. Your spirit man is going to love this right now. He's just going to be rejoicing. He's happy as rain right now. Get ready. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. First line. For he had founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? He that has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to or sworn deceitfully. Oh, wow. Jesus, he's the righteous one, the holy one. Listen, even so, the soul that is quickened by the Spirit of God, which is Jesus himself. He says, you are saved by grace, not works, lest any man should boast. Because it's he at work in us, quickening us. Verse 5, he shall receive the blessing from the Lord and the righteousness from the God of his salvation. What is the meaning of Jesus, the Lord, our salvation? Oh my goodness. I'm getting excited. Okay. Be anxious for nothing, your prayer and supplication, present your request to God. So Abraham knew Jesus. Abraham knew Jesus? But Jesus came after Abraham. What are you saying? Well, Abraham said, the Lord is our salvation. Jonah knew Jesus. Noah knew Jesus. Elijah knew Jesus. They were just calling him by his first name. The Lord, our salvation. When he manifested as man and man could know him, his name was called Jesus, Yeshua, which means the Lord, our salvation. Yeshua. And of course, they translated as Jesus, but we're not doing according to righteous. Listen, we're not getting self-righteous and letters and all this. No, the name, it means the Lord, our salvation. So in verse 5, it says, he shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. So God is going to bless his people and righteousness from the God of his salvation, which is Jesus Christ. Amen. This is the generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob, Selah. Why did he say Jacob? Why did he not say Israel? Because this is the generation that is quickened by his spirit. Jacob was not the firstborn. He was not the eldest. Jacob's name alone tells us who he was. He was a deceitful one. He was a thief because he stole the birthright. But he didn't really steal the birthright because Esau gave it to him. So he was deceitful in a sense. Okay, but listen. This is the generation of them that seek thy face. This is the generation of him that seek that of them that seek him. That seek thy face, O Jacob, Selah. So you're like telling Jacob, okay, this is your generation. This is it. This is the ones that it's not righteousness that they are. It's not by the land of Israel or the heredity of the forefathers of Israel. No, it's the heredity of the Holy Spirit, the fullness of the Gentiles, the grafting in into the olive tree. Remember that? Here's what he's saying. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, because Adam and Eve were cast out. It was a sad time in heaven. God was not happy. He was sad. Lift up your head, O ye gates, because remember he said the soul that sins will die. But what does God desire? God desires all to come to repentance and be saved. All. So he says, my heart is beating so fast. Be anxious for nothing. Psalms 24, verse 7. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors. So, two things. The gates of heaven were closed to Adam and Eve. But hell was waiting too. Because now that they could die because they disobeyed God. He said, don't touch the fruit, and he did. So now the gates of heaven, it says, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors. And the King of Glory will come in. And Father showed us today even. So what was preventing them? Death and Satan, which is hell, because that's where he's going. So we say Satan is the one who's in hell, right? But he's not in hell, he's on the earth. So, okay, try not to get anxious. Okay, lift up your heads, O ye gates of heaven, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors. And the King of Glory shall come in. So there's an announcement. There's an announcement of Jesus. The King of Glory. And here's what Satan's saying. Who's this King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty. Ah, he said in Exodus 14:14, be still. The Lord will fight for you. Who fought for us on Calvary? Jesus, amen. The God of our salvation. Try not to get excited. Okay, this is hard. Okay, here we go. Psalms 24, here we go. And he says, the Lord mighty in battle. He said, be still, and the Lord will fight for you. Do we need to go there? Not really? We do. Okay, we do. The boss says we do. The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord will fight for you. You're the God who stays the same. You are my God. The Lord will fight for you. There we go. He will perfect that which concerns you. Exodus 14:14. Taking a little Old Testament. Oh, all through. It's everywhere. He's the unchanging God. Exodus 14:14, and it says, but Moses, verse 13 to 14, but Moses told the people, so remember what they're seeing, the Egyptians on that side, the sea on this side, we're a sandwich, what's going on? It seems like it's hopeless. And Moses spoke to the people and said, do not be afraid, be still. stand firm, and you will see the Lord's salvation, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians you see today, you'll see them never again. The Lord will fight for you. You only need to be still. Amen. So, wow. In Deuteronomy 1:30, the Lord God who goes before you. Remember the fire? Remember the seas were parted and the ground hardened? And he led his people. The Lord will go before you, just like he did. Oh, in every single biblical story, God has fought the battle. And it's all been a spiritual battle. It's a spiritual battle. The Spirit of the Lord quickened them to victory. Amen. And he quickened us to victory. Hallelujah. Okay, glory to God. Not getting excited, Papa. Okay. Now we're going back into Psalms 24. Here we go. So the grave has to give up its dead. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your power? Something like, oh, grave, where is your sting? Oh, death, where is your power? Whichever way it goes. Either way, both lost. And now, Hades has to give up their souls. So here's what he says in Psalms 24, verse, where are we? Verse 7. So he's saying, who's the King of Glory? Who has charge here? What? What's going on? Hello. The Lord strong and mighty, the most mighty in battle. You waged a bet that you could never win, devil. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty in battle. Verse 7, verse 8. And then he says, lift up your heads, O ye gates. Even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King's glory shall come in. Even so, death is overcome. Even so, the gates of heaven has to be split wide open, because the gates of hell was ripped open. And the keys, that is, remember he said, I give you keys that no man can shut. You could open doors no man can shut. That's what he's talking about. He's giving you the keys to the kingdom. And where, Papa? Ooh, I hear him saying it's come time for the saints to possess the kingdom. It came time for the saints to possess the kingdom. I don't know what song is that. You're singing there. Mercy me. Daniel 7, verse 22. Okay, so what are we talking about? Of course, we were talking about just now the resurrection of Christ, the defeating of death, and now what? Hell, and then, of course, the coming of the Savior himself, the coming of our Lord. We shall behold him in the clouds. Hallelujah. We shall behold him in the clouds, the King of Glory. That's what we're talking about. So Daniel 7:22. Reading from verse 21 to 23. As I watched, this horn was waging war against the saints and prevailing against them. So in times, okay, so this horn represents a power in a kingdom that is, my hair feels so warm, that is opposing the what? The word of God. It's opposing the word of God. Both ways. And that's why in Revelations, wow, Father leaves nothing undone. He leaves nothing, like, he's giving revelation, okay? So, what was I saying? Oh my goodness, no, don't lose it. Okay, right. So, this is the power that was waging war against the saints of God. And the Bible tells us, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God. Ooh, I shut down for a minute. That keep the commandments of God and the word of testimony. What is that? Well, the Bible says they're keeping the word, the commandments, which is the written, and then they're keeping the testimony of the faith of Jesus. So they're upholding his majesty, his authority. They're lifting it higher. They're lifting it up to a world or a power or a system or a kingdom that is saying no. That's what the system is saying. The system is saying no. This is the way. This way is best. And God's word is saying no. God's authority in his word is sovereign. It will not be changed. So there's a little bit of revelation where it's not just physical, but it's spiritual. Just like it was physical in the Old Testament, and now it's spiritual in the New Testament. Well, in the Bible, the Bible comes spiritually, and the Bible comes physically. The Bible comes spiritually. But the whole thing is won by the Spirit of God. Okay? Worship his holy name. Okay. We're going back into Psalms 24. Just to read the last. Okay, here we go. Verse 9 to 10. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. Even lift them up, ye everlasting door. And the King of glory shall come in. Even so, you know where he wants to come in? You know where he's knocking? The door of your heart. Your mind. He wants to dine with you. He wants to teach you. He wants to love on you. And then he wants to bring you into his marvelous kingdom. In things that he's prepared for you. That you'll look upon this world and say, oh, why did I ever? What? You're going to walk on streets of gold, beloved. Verse 10, who is this King of glory? And here's where he announced his name. Both as the Lord strong and mighty, so he fought the battle on Calvary. And now he's announcing himself as God Almighty. In verse 10 of Psalms 24, the Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory, Selah. Wow, look how he did that. And he did that several times. Where? He did it there. He did it in his name, Jesus Christ. Jesus meaning the Lord our salvation, Savior. And Christ meaning holy or anointed one, God Almighty. He did it in Revelation where he said, I am the Alpha and the Omega. Come on. Oh, wow. Okay, I hope you guys are happy as I'm happy. I'm just rejoicing here. I'm hyper. Okay, let's go into, let's just go to see if I left out anything. I can breathe. Okay, so what were we looking at just now? The battling, the warring against the saints. And God showed us that it's going to be a physical and spiritual battle, but the whole battle is won by the Spirit of God. The physical battle is won by the Spirit of God. And the physical battle is won by the Spirit of God. And the spiritual battle is won by the Spirit of God. Because it's only God. That's why we say to God be the glory, the praise, and the honor. It belongs all to him. Oh, wow. Oh, my gosh. Oh, gosh. Father in heaven, you reign, you rule. Ah, glory. I'm overtaken. Okay, Father. So he's the one who are quickening us by his Spirit, because he is the one quickening us, because it's him who's quickening us. Remember he said, as I and my Father are one, you and I are one. Hint, hint. So he was, Savior was just a way to draw you close. So in essence, he didn't lie to us. He didn't deceive us. He just did all things for the righteous purpose of his name, that all souls might be saved if it were possible. But of course, some are choosing the way of the world. Some are not esteeming him in the way that he deserves. Some are, they don't care. They don't care. And it's going to be a sad time, because while they think they don't care, and the end of life is this, that, you know, life just goes on until you die, and then you just, whatever, you die. God is saying, no, it's not the way that it is. You'll be in heaven with me. I want you in heaven with me. Because I loved Adam and Eve. I love them so much that I gave them a way back to me. And you are their kids. Amen? And all my friends, all the holy and righteous people, he says, I want them with me in heaven. I'm not an unfair judge. I'm a just judge. I'm a righteous God. And I want you in heaven with me. So let's just read to see if I left out anything. We're reading, I'm going back through all the scriptures now, again, a recap. So we look until the Ancient of Days arrived. Did we read it? Daniel 7:22, we read it, right? No, we didn't read it yet. Oh, verse 22, until the Ancient of Days arrived and pronounced judgment in favor of the saints of the Most High. He pronounced favor in saints of the Most High. Why? They upheld his glory. They didn't allow it to be trodden underfoot. And they rather die than believe a lie, than bow to a lie. The time came for them to possess the kingdom. What does that mean? Rapture time. Time came for the dead to rise and the living to be caught up with them who are in Christ and be taken to the kingdom. And this is what he said, the full east is a fourth kingdom that will appear on the earth, different from all other kingdoms, and it'll devour the whole earth. The whole earth. Because Satan's kingdom, his throne, is there. He has set up his throne there. And he's giving the beast power, the limited power that God is allowing to have, that God might show his glory is greater. Okay. So we looked at Psalm 24 in total. Romans 8, we read that completely. Maybe I should exit off while I go now. Okay, John 14, we looked at that, and he's going back. He's going away, and then he's coming back. And he said, if you love me, John 14, 28, you would rejoice that I'm going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. I just exit that off, I don't know why. Okay, John, we looked at where they heard the voice coming from heaven when he was baptized in John 12. Now, this is what I didn't read. I should have read it, but I didn't read it yet. So, in Revelations 22:9, I have to do a sermon on this, he's telling me right now, because there are worship of angels. People are worshiping angels. Okay, Revelations 22:9, verse 8 to 10. And I'm John, the one who heard and saw these things. And when I had heard and seen them, I fell down to worship the feet of the angel who had shown me these things. Verse 9, but he said to me, do not do that. I am a fellow servant with you and your brothers, the prophets, and with those who keep the words of this book. He's our brother. The angels are our brothers. Listen, worship God. Why? Because they're one. They're in sync with God. The holy angels, they are the manifestation of who God is. They are in sync with him like Adam was in sync with God. And of course, they see the punishment that Satan's getting. They don't want that. And they worship God out of loyalty, love, adoration. These are holy angels. So the first thing is the fear of the Lord. Okay, and verse 9, he said to me, don't do that, for I'm a fellow servant with you and your brothers, the prophets, and with those who keep the words of this book. Worship God. He pointed him immediately to God. And he told me, do not seal up the words of prophecy in this book, because the time is near. Okay. Then we looked at John 12, 31. We looked at so many. I'm looking for ones that we didn't do. This is an empty tab. We looked at Zechariah 9:9 with, did we look at it in Zion? So it says, when we were looking at Jesus coming as the king on the donkey. Right. He wants me here now. That's why I laughed so hard today. He came to them riding on a donkey. What they're expecting? A horse in glory with a robe and a crown and multitudes. A big multitude. That's what they're expecting, right? A shiny, polished king. That's why when the Antichrist appears, they're gonna receive him. Even he might come as, you know, polished and shiny. Makes you think of somebody polished and shiny. With gold and purple and scarlet. Anyway, that's another scripture and that's another story. So it says, O daughter of Zion, daughter Israel, daughter Jerusalem, shout. Your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, on a foal of a donkey. So he does two things there. He speaks of his name as the lion, because he's the king of kings. And he speaks of his name as the lamb, lowly, humble. He's coming for what? To die for us. What do you think he came for? He's coming to die for us. So even though he can do this, and everything would be eradicated in 2 seconds, he's coming to die for us because he loves us. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Amen. Now, they didn't esteem him in that, I mean, those who crucified him didn't esteem him. They esteemed him. They wouldn't have crucified him, right? Wow. Okay. So, and then we looked at them blocking up the gates with a cemetery that he won't come because they don't believe that he came yet. So they expect him to come through those gates. But he came through, he came through those gates, those very gates. He came through those gates and he also busted open the gates of what? Death and hell. Amen. The King of Glory. It comes back to the King of Glory because he is the King of Glory. Now, okay. Drinking as much water as I possibly can. Second Timothy 3:5. Tells us of that form of godliness that they carry, and they deny his power. Satan, the Lord rebuke you in Jesus' name. Whatever's coming by the window to peek or just distract, it's annoying. 2 Timothy 3, verse 5 to 7. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. So they're giving you its and bits, pieces, but they're not giving you the whole thing. Why? Because they want the glory for themselves. My goodness. They want the glory for themselves. They want the eye pleasing. They want to be esteemed by men. They want the titles, and they want their churches and pews filled. And it says, 2 Timothy 3, verse 4 to 7. Traitors, heady, high-minded, heady, fat-headed, big-headed, egotistic. Traitors, heady, drunk, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than of God. And this is where the world is at today. Above purpose, we place pleasures, so we don't receive what we are fully here for. And that's why it's gone into a whole bunch of craziness. Transgender, gayness, I don't know what you call, I don't even know what you call mixing humans with animals, marrying a tree, a table, your cup. Woo! It's my favorite box. I want to marry it. Marry me, and we shall be together till you get dumped into the bin. See how weird that is? Okay, Father's sending me here right now. Romans 1, 20 to 29. So this is where pride takes us. And if we read this, we'll see where God gave them up. Ah, oh my legs, oh mercy, okay, ah. I feel like an old woman. I'm like, I got cramp. Okay, Romans, what did I say? 20 to 29. And this is why they're publishing all different versions of the Bible, that they could take out words, and they'll say, oh, this word substitutes that word. When you check that word, it's different. I tell you and I bear witness today that the King James Version is the best version of the Bible. Why? 99.9% of the times, whenever Father speaks to me, I get it 99% of the times here. The next one is the NIV version. So we're reading Romans 1:20. This is how gayness came about. This is how abusing animals came about. This is how marrying trees and a sneaker and I don't know what else people marry, dolls and goats and... Okay, let's just read. Romans 1:20. Can I have the version, please? Thank you very much. And it says, after this, I'm going to pray, okay? Well, no, I have a few more. Okay. Romans 1, 20 to 29. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. So he purposed it and he brought it forth. Even us. Even his eternal power and Godhead. So they are without excuse. He upholds all things by the word of his. How do planets be suspend in the space? We came from a blob. Where did that blob come from? It's a big bang. Yeah, God said, let there be light. That's the big bang. Okay. Romans 1:21. Trying to be calm. Because of that, when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. Remember we're speaking about that today? And it's the same thing as not esteeming Jesus as Savior on the cross. Okay. And not say, okay, when he said, I am he, they wanted to stone him. So Romans 1:21. Because that, when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful. So they're like this right now. They're exalt. They're holding. They're trying to hold. They're shutting up the kingdom of heaven from men, and they're not entering into it themselves. We're looking at proud teachers. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful. What? They were not thankful for their souls being saved from eternal fire? That's horrible. We're going to read more. But became vain, in their imaginations. Their foolish heart was darkened, just like Satan. Satan was all beautiful and created, and then his countenance dropped because pride came in him. He thought he knew it all, and he forgot God. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools A fool says in his heart, there is no God, by the way. Romans 1:23. This is where it comes in. And they change the glory of the uncorruptible God. So they don't want to worship the unseen God who's holy and pure and just. And no. To an image made like unto corruptible man. So they begin to worship each other. And birds. And four-footed beasts. And creeping things. Hence the worship of snakes. And idols. And cattle. And elephants, and cows, and whatever else they worship. Wherefore, that is, therefore, God gave them up. What? What did God do? God gave them up to the uncleanliness through the lust of their own hearts. He allowed them to go after the thing. Because they were purposed in their hearts for it. They wanted to do that. God gave them up to the uncleanliness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Verse 25, who changed the truth of God to a lie. They exchange, remember? They slip in their words. And some just changed the whole thing altogether. And worshipped and served the creature, the thing made, more than the creator, who is blessed forever and ever. Amen. Father be glorified. Verse 26. For this cause God gave them up to vile affections. Even their woman, did exchange the natural use into that which is against nature. That's where the inventions of toys and sexual toys and women and all the other things, okay? All the other things that I don't want to go right now, make me a little bit uncomfortable to go into that. But Apostle Scott went into that. oral sex and all this. Okay, listen. Even the woman did change the natural use into that which is against nature. They weren't made to do that. Listen. And likewise also the men. Leaving the natural use of the woman, verse 27 of Romans 1, burned in their lust towards one another. Men for men. Men with men working that which is unseemly in the anus, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meant. They did the thing that is disgusting, and they will reap, receiving in themselves their error which was meant. God never made man for man. It was their error. They thought they knew more than God. Verse 28 to 29. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whispers, gossipers, and it goes on and on and on. I really just don't want to read the rest of it. But okay, so pride makes us foolish, and this is how gayness came about. This is how homosexuality came about. Transgender came about. Abusing animals came about. Lesbianism. All of that. Okay, everything. Oh my goodness. Listen. If you get the point. Worshipping of idols. You name it. They thought they knew better than God. Okay. A scripture I didn't read today was, unless you become like a child. So instead of being like this, blocking him out, now you gotta be like this. You gotta switch. Stand the course upright and find yourself under the blood of Calvary's cross, okay? Here we go. Matthew 18:3. I'm almost done. I think. My energy is almost done. Matthew 18:2-4. Jesus called a little child to stand among them. Truly I tell you, he said, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself like this child is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. He calls us into humility, to listen to Father when he speaks. Amen? Now Father says, for now, this is going on. The death of the saints, because they're lifting up the word and the testimony of Jesus that comes by the spirit of prophecy, which is Jesus himself who causes us to prophesy, which is Revelations 19 somewhere, I think 10 or 11. Psalms 116:15 tells us, verse 14-16, I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of all his saints. Verse 16, truly, O Lord, I'm your servant. I'm your servant, the son of your maidservant. You have released my bonds. We are his servants and daughters and sons of his maid and manservant, which is Abraham and Noah and all of these, we are under Adam, just like all came through Adam, all lived through Christ. Now the spirit of truth wants to come and dwell in you. You got to allow him, because he's the Almighty himself. Shah Moshikahia Sahabihia Amahia Kia Oriyama. He's the light. He's the light of us. He's the sustenance. He wants to come in and lead you into truth. John 16:13, he says, however, wow, Father, I love your fire. Give me more. John 16:13, he says, verse 12-14. I still have much to tell you, but you cannot yet bear to hear it. However, when the Spirit of Truth comes, when you receive the Holy Spirit, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own, but he'll speak what he hears, and he will declare to you what is to come. He will glorify me by taking from what is mine and disclosing it to you. What is he saying? Alignment 222. Here we go. He says, remember, he says, when the helper, the advocate comes, he will teach us all things. He will remind us of what was spoken. He will glorify me by taking from what is mine and disclosing it to you. The truth. God wants us in the truth. Okay, we go a little deeper into, well, this is the beginning of where we started. And we have to look, of course, at the spirit of prophecy, because there it is. I knew he was going to lead us. I didn't think I had to look for it, but we have to just read it. Revelations 19:10, reading from verse 9-11. So we're reading, and it says, why didn't it find? Oh, this is where it came in. He's telling him about the spirit of prophecy. He's explaining to him what it is. So the devil had a lie made up and said that Adventist, 70 Adventists, called the spirit of prophecy Ellen White's spirit. And there was a whole controversy about her being a Freemason and all of that. And I don't know, whatever. But the Bible gives us the spirit of prophecy and tells us exactly what it is. Okay, so in Revelations 19:9 to 11. Oh, my eyes. Okay, stop. Revelations 9:11. 19:9-11. What am I saying? Okay, here you go. And it says, and then he said to me, write, blessed are they who are called to Marsupial, the Lamb, the rapture. And he said to me, these are the true sayings of God. Verse 10. And I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, see that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus. The Lord is our salvation. Why is he saying this? I'm going to tell you in another sermon where the angel is bearing testimony of Jesus as God, the salvation, the God, the one who saves, God, the merciful one. Because he could have cast them all down with Satan, but he didn't. Listen. He's a just God. Don't let that escape you. He's a just God. So here's what he says. See that you don't do that. I'm your fellow servant and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus. The angel saying that. Worship God. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. There we go. And again, Amos 3:7. So before disaster strikes and before the Lord comes, he's pouring out the spirit. He is telling people, he's giving signs in that. What thing he said, he'll make himself known in dreams and visions. In those days, I'll pour out my spirit on all flesh. Okay, so Amos 3, verse 6 to 8, gives us a peek. And it says, if a trumpet sounds in a city, will not the people tremble? The EMP is coming. If calamity comes to a city, has not the Lord caused it? We're looking at Sodom and Gomorrah, by the way. And verse 7, surely the Lord God does nothing without revealing it to his servants, the prophets. The lion has roared. Who will not fear? The Lion of Judah. The Lord God has spoken. Who will not prophesy? That is a hard one. That's why when I see things and when he gives me visions, I have to give, because if I don't, then I can't function. You beat me. I don't know. Honestly, I can't. I become unfunctionable. I become just irritated and just, I cannot give that word that he gives. It burns in me. Luke 18:7. 27, what are we looking at here? Oh, what are we looking at here? Oh, God will do the thing. Okay, so we were looking at, it says in verse 26 to 28, those who heard this, heard what? Who then can be saved? Because Jesus, he gave a whole thing, and now it's like, who then can be saved? What? But Jesus said, what is it? What is impossible with man is possible with God. Now, this means for all our impossible cases, yes. But here we go. Shall I give you a spiritual insight on it? What is impossible with man is possible with God. He says, it is impossible for the flesh to not be like this. To be like what? Hostile with God, hating God. It is impossible because the flesh is hostile with God. But when the Spirit of God comes and dwells in us, then our spirit man is fed. And then the spirit man can, you know, follow God, go love on God, not be hostile. But the flesh has to come under submission to the spirit man. So when he says what is impossible with man is possible with God, he means all his miracles, all of that, yes. But when he said, when he referred to salvation, he means you've been saved. you've been pardoned from your transgression and iniquity. Now, not that you should trample, just go continue doing the thing, because the blood of Jesus is there, and I'll just go take a shower and just use it as soap, more blood. No. What in the world? He died because of our sins. We don't do that. So the Bible calls us to not be like pigs and dogs like we did this evening, remember? So he says, that's why he said, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom and understanding. The fear of the Lord. Work out your salvation. So you're washed by his blood and you're cleansed to walk in what? The path of sin again? No, the path of righteousness. Okay, here we go. And of course, we looked at, you know, the men interpreting the dream for the king. They couldn't do it. Only Daniel could do it. Daniel was a righteous man before God, and he was filled with the Spirit of God. So we were looking at Daniel interpreting the king's dream. That was this evening, remember? And then the final one was when the decree went out, he was not ashamed. So in Daniel 2, we looked at the decree was placed, and no one can worship any other thing in the land except this statue or whatever they put there, whatever. No one could worship anything else except this thing for 30 days. And Daniel refused to what? Worship the thing. He went into his room or in his house as normal, opened the window so they could see. Can you see me? I hope you can see me. Well, God bless you. I know the decree. And he went in the quietness of his heart and he worshiped. Is that what it said? No, Daniel prayed as is customary. And the men came and they saw him. All right. So now, Father, the King of Glory, this was intense. Now he's saying that Christians are being persecuted around the world. Christians are being killed. Those who lift up the word of God, they're hated. They're put out of synagogues and churches. They're persecuted. And they are, they're hated by the world. Are you ready to join this movement? Are you ready? But they're going to heaven. So, are you ready to join the family that's going to be in heaven? The Bible says, now is the hour of salvation and today is the day. Amen. He said, you need to do one thing. The Bible says, believe in your heart. Believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and you shall be saved. So tonight I want to say a prayer for you, brother. Brother Marcus, I want to pray for you. I want to pray for you, Brother Israel. I want to pray for you, all the brothers and sisters out there, as well as myself. And just say a prayer because we know now who the King of Glory is. We have seen his majesty. And it was just like, I'm speechless for the revelation, okay? I'm speechless. But Father, you reign and you rule. You know that. You're the boss. You're the boss, Daddy. Okay, so let's pray together as a family. Father, I come to you a sinner. I lay down my shortcomings, my fleshy things, my thoughts, my words, my actions, Lord God. And everything that I have done that is displeasing your sight, I lay down at the cross of Calvary. Because I heard, Lord God, that you provided a way out for me. That I didn't need to be a slave of this world or this empty routine, but I could be a part of such an exciting life as a follower of you, Lord Jesus. Father, right now, I invite you, Jesus, into my life. I invite you to wash me and cleanse me in your precious blood, to fill me up with your Holy Spirit, to renew my mind and cleanse my heart and give me a new spirit in you, Father, just like your son says. Father, even so right now, just as Ezekiel says, Father, I thank you that you're washing me right now. You're washing the filth of pride from my mind and my heart. You are quickening me by the fire of your spirit. You are, even so right now, you are doing the work in my heart. And Lord, right now I open my heart to you. I say, come into my life and change me. And I'll follow you all the days of my life. I receive you now as my Savior and my Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you so much. Thank you for all that you've done for me. Work in me. Use me. Give me this purpose. Give me this fire. Set me on fire. Use me, Lord God. Use me for your glory. And I will follow you all the days of my life. Prepare me for your soon coming. And I promise I'll never deny your name. And even if I deny, Father, come after me until I turn back to you again. In Jesus' name. Father, I just thank you for your love and your mercy and your grace. That is enough. It is enough. Because you are enough. And when I have you, I have everything. Thank you, Father. In your holy and precious name, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Now, beloved, that was a bit long, but it was from the heart. Amen. The Bible says, if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you shall be saved. And, of course, to work out your own salvation is to make the choice. You make the choice. He does the work. But you make the choice because you have the power to make that choice, not the power of the consequences, but you have the power to make the choice. So work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Let the King of Glory come in. Amen. Come into our lives, come into our hearts, come into our spirit. Oh, dwell with us, Father. Come into us and change us and make us new and in the way that you want us to be. Our beloved, the gates of heaven are open. And heaven is rejoicing for the so many souls that are going to be saved. Thank you, Father, for all that are finding the truth, for all that are getting a witness of the truth, for all that are getting a deeper relationship with Jesus, for all that are magnifying him as God. The graves are giving up their dead, because what is dead must come to life. And hell has handed over the keys. So get your house keys, your car keys, whatever, and just shake it. Bless it and say, this is the key that God gave me. I want you to get a new key. Okay, here's a little something, okay? Get a pretty key, a key you can find. Get a key, a new key. And put it on a string and keep it with you. Not to idolize it. You're not idolizing anything. But you're reminded that you have the key. Or put it somewhere you can see. And let your mind always remember, every time you see this key, that Jesus gave you the key to open doors your mind could shut and shut doors your mind could open. That was an instruction in the spirit, by the way. So whoever do it, they're blessed and they'll be strengthened. Whoever, I don't know, what, it's your choice. Again, we have the choice, but we don't choose the consequences. God is God and he'll forever be God. He's greatly to be magnified. He has the power to destroy the soul and the body. So don't give yourself up to a reprobate mind. Don't give yourself up to an evil heart. Don't give yourself up to a mind that's in the world, to wildness, to parties, and all this kind of nonsense that people do, okay? Don't give yourself up. It's not too late. It's not too late. It's late. But it's not too late. So run to the cross. Ow. Run to the cross. Surrender your heart, your soul, your mind. And tell Father, take over. And just like that, he takes it. And he renews you and he sets you on the path. So you walk in the light. on the truth and the way that is He, and you'll never again be the same. I love you, beloved. Abba Father loves you. And I hope this was encouraging to you. I knew it was super encouraging to me. Wow. It empowered my spirit man so much, and I know it's going to empower you. So share it. Bless someone with it. Bless someone with it. I know the visual is never good. I don't care about the visual. You don't need to see me. You need to hear the word. Amen? Because faith come by hearing, hearing by the word. Brother Marcus, you are blessed. Come out of that, brother. Brother Israel, you are blessed. And everybody else who would come, you are blessed and highly favored of the Lord. Amen? Come to the Lord today. He is worthy to be praised, to be magnified and glorified. He is the King of glory, the Lord strong and mighty, and He is coming very soon. We're going to see Him gracing the skies very soon. And you want to be on that right path. You want to be in the path of the righteous. You want to be walking with Him. You want to be talking with Him. You want to be just quickened by His Spirit, that when He says, come up hither, He said, with all my heart, I desire it. And tonight I'm going. Or today. Why did I say tonight first? I don't know why I said tonight first. Maybe it's night. Maybe it's night. I don't know. I said night, didn't I? I never speak something without a purpose. But God is saying, come. Come. Be changed. Come. Come into my kingdom. God bless you, beloved. I love you. And Jesus loves you. Amen. Let me just title this thing and then I'll go. So, He's worthy. It's not too late. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors. Okay. This thing is stuck. I'm not going to rhyme. I'm not going to say talk. Come on, it's stuck. It's already safe, I think. I hope. They can't block it out because I've already said that all copyright music belongs to their owners, so they can't block this out. So God bless you. Share it. Share it, share it, share it. Oh, come on. You guys do your part and share it. Thank you, Father, for your word in your holy and precious name, Jesus Christ. Bye, beloved. God bless you. I thought I ended it. I'm like waving and I press save. What?